Good morning, everyone, and welcome back. Thanks for sticking with us. I'm Josh Goldman, co-chair of the symposium, and it's my pleasure to welcome back to the law school today our keynote speaker, Neil Auerbach. It's often said that the worst place to stand at a conference is between the audience and lunch, but I'm confident that our keynote speaker today is up to that task. Neil Auerbach is founder and managing partner of Hudson Clean Energy Partners, a leading global private equity firm with more than $1 billion of assets under management invested exclusively in the clean energy sector. As a managing partner, Mr. Auerbach leads Hudson's efforts to engage political and business communities in developing policy frameworks to facilitate clean energy deployment, and he oversees the firm's investments throughout the sector, including wind, solar, geothermal power, biofuels, and a variety of energy efficiency and storage technologies. Earlier in his career, Mr. Auerbach was a partner at Goldman Sachs, where he co-founded the firm's Alternative Energy Investment Group and led some of the most successful investments in renewable energy at the firm. Prior to joining Goldman, Mr. Auerbach was managing director and head of structured capital markets at Barclays Capital and was a principal at Morgan Stanley. After graduating as an LL.M from NYU Law, Mr. Auerbach began his career as a tax attorney, rising to become a partner at McDermott Will & Emery, and later serving as branch chief and assistant to the associate chief of the IRS. Mr. Auerbach is a member of the Leadership Council, the American Council on Renewable Energy, and on the U.S. Council on Competitiveness. He's served on National Commission on Energy Policy and on the Advisory Council of the Prince of Wales Rainforest Project in the UK. He appears frequently in the media to discuss energy policy and markets and recently testified before Congress on the future of America's energy industry. In short, I cannot think of a better person to join us today to share his thoughts on the outlook for renewable energy finance in America. Ladies and gentlemen, Neil Auerbach.
Thank you very much. It's been a challenge to get me back to the law school after 29 years. I've only been here guest lecturing once, and my latest challenge was that someone got a heart attack on the plane that I was just on the way back from San Francisco. So we had actually had to have an emergency landing in Salt Lake City. Now that all those challenges are behind us, I'm going to try to regale you with some tales of being in the markets in clean energy, and would welcome the opportunity to answer questions as well. So if I slur my speech at all over the next 20 or 30 minutes that I'm going to speak, it's not because I was drinking this morning, but I was just trying to get a few hours of shut-eye on the way back from San Francisco. My own odyssey in the world of renewable energy investing began at Goldman Sachs with a first investment that we made well over a decade ago involving the use of a Section 29 tax credit. And the Section 29 credit was put in the law by President Carter, and it involved a much earlier iteration of what it meant to have clean coal. According to the definition, if any of you are familiar with this, I'll just make it nice and simple. It involves coating coal with a polymer and thoroughly mixing it together. The theory there was that you would be reducing dust emissions from coal. Carbon was not actually the thought there. This was an extremely lucrative investment. It got blessed by the Internal Revenue Service, and it generated a 5x return for Goldman Sachs. After doing that investment and realizing here that we were just mixing some materials into coal, we thought, gee, let's try to do something a little bit more socially valuable, but equally profitable. And so we started looking around. This was back in 2002 at renewable technologies. But the world back then was completely different. This was a cottage industry, and in came Big Bad Goldman Sachs to try to figure out how to accelerate its development. And we did find ways of doing that. So along the way, back in the early part of the last decade, we became pioneers in developing the tax equity market in the US. Today, the financing market that actually is the engine of renewable energy finance in the United States. We launched the first solar power purchase agreement about 7 or 8 years ago on behalf of a very innovative company by the name of SunEdison that had a vision to be the leading solar utility in the United States. and did go on to become the largest solar downstream player in the United States, and we backed that company. We also invested in the most successful PE-backed, private equity-backed wind energy developer in the U.S. called Horizon Wind, generating a billion-dollar return for Goldman Sachs when we sold it at the height of the market to a Portuguese utility. And last but not least, we had the great privilege of investing, the only private equity investor, in a company called First Solar, which many of you know went on to become the most successful solar company in the world. We were very fortunate at Goldman Sachs to be in the right place at the right time and investing in the right companies. The market for clean energy and clean energy equities at that time, from the area about 2003 to 2007, was booming. And by the way, obviously all under the Bush administration. At the end of the Bush years, the collapse of the bull market, accelerated by the demise of Lehman, changed the mood for investment in nearly all asset classes, as you well know, and including renewable energy. The pace of investment growth in renewable energy slowed markedly for a while, and the value of equities plummeted. It was simply unable, the equity markets for clean energy were unable to sustain the expectations of investors for perpetual strong double-digit growth rates. Interestingly though, total global capital invested in our sector continued to grow throughout the global recession that actually began in 2007. Now, the growth of the renewable energy sector from 2002 through 2008, if you study it, and I'll give you my perspective on this, was the product of three trend lines that fueled the positive storyline and came together to fuel a tremendous 10x growth in our sector over a relatively short period of time. The first was massive fiscal stimulus around the world that ignited the growth of the industry. Rising energy prices, both in fuel and in power, spurred by spikes in the price of natural gas in all markets, but particularly in the United States. And also, at that time, a growing global commitment to an accord on climate change. At first, the impact of the sudden deceleration of the global economy had little impact on our industry, as I've noticed, because a number of the countries around the world saw green stimulus as the way to ignite their economies. And so this was a global phenomenon, the US, China, and many countries in Europe. So although equities hit bottom in March 2009, along actually with all other markets, it was remarkable how much convergence there was going on in global markets. Clean energy stocks began to recover as a result of all of that stimulus coming into the market. And the most relevant index here for clean energy equities, called the NAX, nearly doubled in value over the next 2 years following March 2009, but only coming to about half of its value at the very peak of the bull market. And clean energy investment continued to soar around the world. The US and China became competitors in the global foot race to become the dominant power in clean energy, this time now under the Obama administration. However, the stimulus of 2009 sowed the seeds of a very bad crop in 2011. And the renewable energy industry today is still feeling the hangover of the spending binge in two very important ways. First, China kicked off their plan of becoming the global dominant player in renewable energy manufacturing in 2009. That was part of their plan even earlier, but they definitely went into high gear in 2009, investing tens of billions of dollars in manufacturing capacity in wind and in solar in particular, creating massive capacity gluts that destroyed operating margins for all manufacturers, nearly all manufacturers in those industries. Secondly, the massive fiscal stimulus created a massive supply of renewable energy in countries leading the renewable energy push. So capacity grew dramatically in places like Spain, Italy, Germany, and a host of other countries, and even the United States. So this pace of accelerated growth In particular in solar, which has, still today has a somewhat higher cost structure, and back then even a much higher cost structure, created problems for those governments in one of the following three areas, one or multiple of these areas. First of all, unanticipated budget deficits from the large supply response to that stimulus. The stimulus comes in and massive amounts of capacity get built and the governments have to pay for it. So huge deficits starting to pop up. The second, unanticipated increases as a result of that massive supply increase in the power prices paid by consumers in those countries that are actually, for which the cost of that renewable energy build is actually being passed along to customers, particularly in Germany, but there are other countries as well. And third, and most interestingly, and I wish I could really dwell on this subject here, there would probably be five of you that would be interested in this, and the rest of you would go to sleep, but I'm actually fascinated by it, which is the incredible disruption that the massive increase in intermittent generation had on power markets that were starting to experience increasing levels of renewable energy in those markets. They started wreaking havoc on those power markets, creating unprecedented volatility in either price, load, or both. So as a consequence, governments have increasingly expressed the willingness and have actually taken action to do the once unthinkable, which is to change the rules of the game on renewable energy owners retroactively after you brought into the asset under an expected set of rules. I actually refer to that behavior as outright government expropriation of private property. So we're not going to spend a lot of time on this today, but if you want to take away one kernel of at least my version of received wisdom on this, is that this is the biggest threat to the continued growth of renewable energy and its ability to finance itself at a reasonable or increasing lower cost of capital, because governments around the world are literally killing the goose that laid the golden egg by upsetting the expectations of owners of these assets and retroactively decreasing their yield. So let's go back to the narrative. So 2011, I said that the train starts going off the tracks, even though global renewable energy spend continues at a pretty impressive clip. And actually, over the last few years, nearly equaling global spend on new fossil fuel powered generation. However, as the rest of the equity markets in 2011 continue their steady climb from the low in March 2009, all of a sudden, in April 2011, you start to see the phenomenon. And I'm sorry, if I hadn't been on the plane overnight, I would have brought a beautiful slide that actually shows you the ups and downs of the equity markets. But you can trace it back to April 2011, and all of a sudden, equities start to reverse in our sector. IPO issuance nearly disappears. Risk tolerance evaporates in our market, and bankruptcies in our space begin to soar. This situation still persists today and is now, only recently over the last, I'd say, 60 days, showing clear signs of reversal. So what happened? What's really going on? Without oversimplifying the reasons that I believe underlie this trend, I would suggest one major reason and then two secondary reasons. So first and foremost, operating profits disappeared from the supply chain, virtually of everyone in the sector except for financiers. So without operating profits, investors are unwilling to sustain previous valuations of those equities. In addition, the investors in this sector, institutional investors, were faced with the reality that European governments could no longer afford to be the primary driver of the renewable energy industry's growth. They had been for the previous 5 years. And also, investors were faced with the reality that although costs were declining for industry participants, which is a good thing because we're trying to bring the cost down for renewable energy, at the same time, a perception grew that the competition was fiercer than once thought, in particular natural gas, in particular natural gas extracted from shale formations. The price of natural gas started plummeting, making the elusive target of reaching parity with fossil fuel generation more difficult to achieve. And so that that shadow of doubt cast a pall, and still today cast a pall over our industry, although you have also started to see a reversal in natural gas prices, fueled by the fact that most extractors of shale natural gas cannot afford to extract at the depressed prices that prevailed over the last 12 or 18 months. So with all that as backdrop now, if I've helped you all be a little more sophisticated in your view of what's been going on in our markets, it appears to me and to a lot of other industry participants that the way forward for the renewable energy industry to continue to be cost competitive is to identify ways to lower the most intractable cost barrier to grid parity with fossil fuels, and that is lowering the cost of finance. Although the problem looms largest in the U.S., and I'm going to get into that over the next several minutes, the problem with high cost of finance and renewable energy is not only homegrown in the U.S. But you know, if you want to ask me questions about other countries, I'm happy to do that. We finance renewable power generation in about 13 or 14 countries around the world. But the U.S. Is the second largest market for renewable energy. It's hometown for us. And so I want to focus on what's going on at home here and what we can do about it. So just to give you a sense of order of magnitude of how you, by lowering the cost of finance, you can lower the cost of renewable energy in rough orders of magnitude, and I don't have my spreadsheet with you, but we can, if you'll just trust me on this, if we can lower the cost of finance by 100 basis points for renewable energy, we will lower the cost of renewable power for consumers, industrial utilities or retail consumers, by roughly about 7%. Many estimate that there is a lot of cost that can come out of renewable energy finance. I think at least 300 basis points can come out. And so just by developing more efficient ways of financing renewable power generation, we can drop the cost of renewable energy by 20%. And that puts us smack in the middle of the playing field in the competitive race with fossil fuels. And so we are pretty close already. And again, if you want to ask me questions, I can talk about it. But I thought I would get away from the nitty gritty of which of these power sources cost what and where they're going. But in any event, we can cut a lot of costs by making this more efficient. So why are the costs of renewable power too high? And why is that such a widespread belief? In the US, the reasons boil down to two. It's the structure of the system and it's liquidity in the system. They are interrelated. For the past 20 years, the primary tool that has been used by the federal government to stimulate growth in the renewable energy sector has been through the production tax credit and secondarily through the investment tax credit. In the halls of this building, or in the classrooms of this building, I learned how to harness the power of those tax credits for my corporate employers and for clients. It put food on my dinner table. It clothed my kids. It still feeds a cottage industry in the United States. However, I must admit to you that it is a hopelessly inefficient tool for capital formation in renewable energy, as these credits are designed primarily to be used by large corporations, fewer of whom today pay corporate tax in years past, and most of whom are not in the business of lending money or making long-term investments in power plants. It is absolutely wonderful that Google has decided to get into the business of providing tax equity. But relying on just a handful of well-heeled corporations to finance what last year was roughly $35 billion of CapEx in wind and solar in the United States is not a way to operate the economy of the renewable energy industry. In 2010, I co-authored a paper for the Bipartisan Policy Center in which we estimated that between 30 to 40% of the tax benefits flowing through the system, these tax credits were wasted simply based upon the inefficiency of the system. And so by figuring out how to change the method of financing just through eliminating waste, we can get rid of a tremendous amount of cost. So in 2009, and I was aware of this beforehand, actually started sharing this with the Obama administration after they came in, along with a number of professionals, The government tried to help the situation by allowing renewable energy generators to approach the Treasury Department directly to get cash for their tax credits so that they didn't have to go to these big financial intermediaries, hopefully making the system smoother. It worked for a while, and it worked to a certain extent. And I think that this cash grant program that was instituted with the Stimulus Act of ARRA in 2009 has been judged a success. However, the dark side of all of this is that once you put government in charge of being a direct sort of financing window for these renewable energy generators, the big hand of government cannot stop moving into the private affairs of renewable energy generators. And so increasingly, the government decided exactly how much profit the industry participants could take and started, of their own accord, denying cash grants in part to renewable energy generators because they felt that the participants were making too much money. What is going to follow from this is a spate of lawsuits, which the government is almost certainly going to lose. It is completely unauthorized. And it leads me to conclude that some calls in government and private circles for a permanent institution of refundable tax credits to solve the problem of liquidity is not a recipe for success. We're going to put Big Brother in the driver's seat here to dictate how much market participants can earn, and I do not think that is going to work very well. So we're going to have to move on and find other ways of getting this done. So over the last, I would say, 12 months, as industry participants focus more and more on how we lower the cost of renewable energy finance, there are a number of ideas that have been raised. And some of these are going to find their way into law or regulation. The first of them is called the Master Limited Partnership Parity Act, the MLP Parity Act. Have any of you ever heard of the MLP Parity Act? Familiar? OK, so a number of you. Master limited partnerships are tools that Congress developed several decades ago for the oil and gas extraction industry to finance their extraction activities, basically in the form of royalty payments that would be financed by either institutional investors or actually retail investors without the imposition of corporate level tax. It is a massive market today. It is very, very efficient. It funds on an all-in yield basis of roughly 6%. On a pre-tax basis because there's no corporate level tax. Whereas in our industry today, roughly speaking, the industry finances itself on anywhere between 8% and 10% after tax. So you get a sense of the magnitude of the shift that would be available to our industry if we can actually utilize master limited partnerships. Now, one of the problems that the industry has focused on, and by the way, this is being prompted by Senator Coons of Delaware, actually a very interesting fellow. I had dinner with him a while back, and he's a big renewable energy advocate. The problem with his piece of legislation is that he does not allow tax credits to pass through directly to these institutional investors, and so they get stranded, or you have to hire a clever tax lawyer, undoubtedly a graduate of NYU, to figure out how you actually siphon off those tax credits and utilize them at the same time that you're using MLPs. It's all doable. The problem with our industry, frankly, is that sometimes we're our own worst enemy. We have a cottage industry also of lobbyists in Washington who are fed off of desperate folks like us who keep perennially paying them to get those tax credits re-legislated. And so there's a fear that if the MLP legislation passes, a number of people in our industry are afraid that Congress will take the next step and say, well, now that you've got liquidity in your market, you don't need the tax credits anymore, and they're going to eliminate the tax credits. Some of us are not convinced that that's actually isn't such a bad idea, but it's going to kill the jobs of a lot of lobbyists here, and so there is still opposition to this idea, even in our own industry, even though many of the market participants think that this is a great idea and will open up markets. So we don't know where it's going, but there is actually bipartisan support for this. Lisa Murkowski, the senior ranking minority member of the Senate Energy Committee, last week put out a paper in which she strongly endorsed the MLP Parity Act, and Democrats are pretty widely in favor of it as well. The next subject is REITs. solar REITs. I'm not going to get into the details of this. If only a few of you knew about MLPs, even fewer of you will be familiar with the arcane rules around REITs. But REITs are ways of financing, you know, real estate, and is a very liquid tool as well. And so there are efforts underway to avail REITs, which are not that easily accessible to the renewable energy industry, but again, another liquidity tool, very important for our industry. And so right now there's work on it, but there's no clarity yet. An idea that I've been promoting and have been in front of Congress several times to testify is the use of reverse auctions. Reverse auctions sounds arcane, but it's actually really simple. It's an attempt to get for buyers to stand alone and get a bunch of sellers to compete to lower the price of their product or service to the buyer. It's in wide use in the United States in state procurement and some in federal, and many countries around the world have actually gotten behind reverse auctions as a way of lowering the cost of renewable energy. In fact, in Brazil, which is the number one country in the world that's using reverse auctions today, wind energy is the cheapest form of power that you can procure in Brazil because of the use of reverse auctions. So there is actually, there have been several bills, mostly prompted by Republicans who are trying to get market-based solutions into the system so that they can support reverse auctions. And interestingly, to get the oil and gas industry to pay with a direct benefit transfer rather than going into the tax code, the basic idea is let the oil and gas industry run a little wilder, get them to increase their production, get those marginal royalties, pay a portion of the debt down, and siphon off a portion of those royalties into a trust fund that supports renewable energy generation. The president, a few nights ago in his State of the Union speech, endorsed a similar idea for the use of oil and gas royalties to actually accelerate the adoption of alternative fuel technologies. But behind closed doors, there's also discussion about using that concept to achieve a balance, a comfortable balance, give the oil and gas industry what they want, which is expanded drilling, and give the renewable energy advocates what they want, which is cash, but to do so outside of the tax code so that there can be better liquidity, and you don't need to hire, I'm sorry to say, as many lawyers that graduated from the NYU tax program to figure out how to finance renewable energy. And so that idea is gaining traction. Senator Murkowski endorsed that idea. There are a number of Democrats that have endorsed that idea. And House Republicans, interestingly enough for some of you, are actually supporting renewable energy through reverse auctions. So this is actually, I think, pretty promising. If it passes into law, it's probably going to be in the form of a pilot program because we're going to have to iron out the kinks in it. And then lastly, we mentioned federal procurement. One of the best ways to lower the cost of anything, actually, and I'll say this now, even with a $16 trillion deficit standing, basically looking at us, staring us in the face, is to actually use the full faith and credit of the United States. And a very a controversial program that you're well aware of in 2005, the Loan Guarantee Program was put into place in its first iteration. It was refined in 2007 and 9, and billions of dollars of financing has taken place through loan guarantees. I'm sure everyone here has heard of Solyndra, otherwise you were on vacation for 6 months during the presidential election season. So Solyndra is one of the more famed failures of that loan guarantee program. But there are other ways to use the full faith and credit of the United States other than through loan guarantees. The easiest way to do it is just have the government massively increase its procurement of renewable energy. And so they're doing that today in the Department of Defense. They're doing it both on the fuels and the power side. The General Services Administration is bound by a 60-year-old law that prohibits government procurement of power to go beyond 10 years. But even in this market, a 10-year contract with the full faith and credit to buy power backed by the federal government is going to make a big difference. And there is an ability to rapidly ramp that. I was at the White House a couple days ago talking to the folks who are trying to sort out what's going on there and threw this idea on the table. They're well aware of it already, and I do think that you're going to see increased federal procurement of renewable energy. And so if you have the government wallet behind you, you're going to, by definition, lower the cost. So that's a quick survey of where we're going in renewable energy finance markets. I want to mention one more point before I actually breathe and take some questions. and that is the talk about carbon legislation. So the president mentioned it in his State of the Union message. He basically said, okay, it's now time to get back to the drawing board and come up with a piece of legislation that both houses of Congress and Democrats and Republicans can support to tackle climate change. And so he referenced the legislation, the ill-fated legislation of several years ago, otherwise affectionately known as carbon cap and trade. I don't think he seriously expects that law to pass, but what he basically said is, Congress is going to act or I will. And so one of the biggest clubs that the president has that will be difficult for Congress to stop is to use the regulatory power of the EPA to legislate greenhouse gas emissions under the Clean Air Act. There's been a lot of talk about it. The Supreme Court has sanctioned the use of EPA regulation, and it may come, but it's going to cause a political havoc, and I think the president would prefer to see Congress act. If carbon cap and trade doesn't happen, so what happens in its stead? There are two possibilities. One, at least interestingly, intellectually much more appealing, seemingly politically distant, and the other a little bit more possible. So the first one is a carbon tax. There are a host of conservative think tanks that believe this is the way to go. You keep tax rates where they are, even lower corporate income tax rates, and you put a carbon tax and you're actually going to get economic growth out of it. I can refer to you a bunch of white papers that have been written on the subject. And the other is with a national clean energy standard that would also, in addition to renewables, include natural gas, quote unquote, clean coal and nuclear under some formulation. That's been kicking around for a long time. Senator Bingaman didn't really want to go to the mat on that when he was chairman of the Senate Energy Committee. I do think that there's increased prospects here, although Lisa did not put it in her energy blueprint last week. I do believe that there is room for Republicans and Democrats to come together on a sectoral approach to regulating greenhouse gas emissions through basically an electricity sector, either through a carbon tax or through a clean electricity standard. These will all be on the table. My hope is that this is not all political bluster, that the president doesn't choose to focus only on gun control and immigration, and perhaps a little bit on deficit reduction and completely ignore this community. The problems of climate change are real, and something needs to be done. And I by the way, I am a Republican, and I'm proud to also very demonstrably support clean energy. I do believe that there is support in Republican circles for more comprehensive legislation, as long as it's done in a way that does not get the government to be too intrusive in people's lives, and also is very sensitive about increasing the federal share of the total economy, which many Republicans think is already too high. And so there are prospects of this happening. I think you could see a coalition of the willing along the ways that you're seeing right now in immigration reform, where Republicans and Democrats are coming together. And right now, I'm not going to handicap it. It seems like the chances are remote, but over the next couple of months, you may see some surprising news. In any event, something needs to be done to unglue these markets, to get them to move. Our industry is poised for tremendous growth. There has been unbelievable progress in reducing cost. There are more ways. There's definitely a way to go, but I think with a concerted effort by people of goodwill and wisdom, we're going to get there, and hopefully the next 4 years will be a lot better for this industry than the last 2 years. So with that, I'll conclude and ask, and if everyone has any questions.
Hi, thanks so much. Great presentation, and your focus on the financial costs of, or the cost of financial capital versus the cost of the physical capital, I think is absolutely spot on. The way I characterize it is 2/3 of the costs are in the finance costs and only 1/3 in the underlying asset. And I think that's an important thing for people to realize. So in trying to get at that, I'm not sure MLPs and REITs, because I'm one of the five people that actually probably spends his whole day thinking about this problem. It's not clear to me that that's the long-term efficient capital solution and the lowest cost of capital. Why aren't we driving toward a securitization solution, which probably drives another 100 or 200 basis points at least off. And the second part is back to your policy question. Could we support that? The federal government has an extraordinary history of figuring out how to deploy capital in long duration assets. And most of the people in this room have taken advantage of in the form of mortgage support and student loan support. So why aren't we using those tools at the federal level to try to support and drive towards something that would end up being securitized and even cheaper?
Okay, that is a great question. So thank you. I think as you well know, the word securitization is considered a four-letter word in many places, including in the halls of power in Washington. In order to get there, so first of all, this idea is a very, very good one, and I will say that because I've been working on that idea through a private initiative inside Hudson for the last year. One of the problems is that in order to create the tools necessary to have a robust securitization market, you're going to have to create something that looks like a green bank or like the green version of Fannie or Freddie. Try to get that through Congress over the next few years. That's a very tall order. And so the other basic problem, just to get into the bowels of the issue, is that you need to standardize contracts. The rating agencies need to develop a level of sophistication around the hidden risks, or the risks that they don't understand that well, associated with things that can go wrong in renewable energy power projects to create that securitization path. S&P wrote a paper not too long ago outlining their view on it. And I think we're going to move incrementally in that direction, but my view is that because of the political stickiness of using that term and actually figuring out how to institutionalize this with a federal support behind it, it's going to take several years. One possible approach to that is to do it at the state level. So one of my friends, who was an ex-colleague at Goldman Sachs, went to be Secretary Chu's special assistant for renewable energy finance. His name is Richard Kaufman. He was recently appointed, I don't want to call it the czar, but the chief sort of policy expert in helping New York State to do as much as it can on a state level to innovate around renewable energy finance. And so that's going to be one of many ideas that are promoted. It is possible to do this at a state level, but I think this is going to happen organically rather than by legislative fiat through Washington.
I hope that the university transcribes your talk, puts it on their website, and heavily hyperlinks it. I'm wondering, since you describe such things as wind leading in Brazil, where we tend to hear just of Petrobras's major finds offshore, and the fact that the leading growth sector in the energy state of Texas is wind, the main portion of a petroleum geologist's training is as a geologist, that we have this resource that is played out at some point in time. And why do we need to create a level playing field to continue something in the same way as the first Republican administration got rid of, and we still have to fight back on elements of that, of chattel slavery? Why do we have to be chained to this source of energy and all the problems it brings with it? Why can't we push things fully towards renewable and a cradle-to-cradle economic cycle?
Well, it's a great question, and thank you. I'm going to say something in response to you that you may consider a little bit controversial, again, coming from someone who makes his living out of the industry. If I wasn't able to work in a very bipartisan way, my main gig is actually is running a private equity firm, but I have to spend a lot of time in Washington and talking to both sides of Congress, because policy is just at the core of what drives our industry. I think that America today is in a very different position than it was 4 years ago. Americans believe today that we are in a period of energy abundance. Now, even if you dispute some of the geologist's claims on the extent of and the cost of extracting oil and gas from shale, there is almost no doubt that America is the most energy abundant country on the face of the earth. I think Al Gore did a phenomenal service to the world by increasing awareness of climate change, but in many circles he's blamed for actually over-proselytizing and starting to create more friction associated with the largesse of his vision. And all of the above strategy is being endorsed by both sides. Today, in the halls of Congress and among Democrats and Republicans, I'm sorry, among the House and the Senate, Republicans are mostly all of the above. And so I think the best you're going to get here is to try to, quote unquote, level the playing field. You're never going to get a pure level playing field when you're trying to catch up of 100 years. 1857 is that magical year when Pennsylvania became a gusher for oil. And so they've had a 140-year head start on a lot of the technologies that we are deploying now in renewables. But if you look at cost curve declination and you say, how fast can renewable energy compete, get onto a competitive footing, it's remarkable. The solar industry has a progress curve of roughly 22 to 24%, which means every doubling of capacity in the market brings another 22 to 24% reduction in cost. There's no technology that we have seen anywhere in fossil fuels or even in renewables that is even close. In the in wind, it's 7%, or if you include some other factors, you can get up to 14%, but it's a maturing industry. So we're going to get competitive, and so if you remove the barriers, and allow capital to flow more freely, you're going to get what many of us want in this room, which is a much greater penetration of renewables. You're not going to get to the point where you're going to remove all of the political barriers that are backed by hundreds of billions of dollars of wealth to marginalize fossil fuels. That's not going to happen anytime soon. Lunch, I guess, right? Okay, thanks.